Our guest today was elected to represent Illinois' 5th Congressional District a little over 7 years ago. He is the only Illinois member in the House who serves on the Appropriations Committee. Our guest today did his undergraduate work at Roosevelt University. There we go, Roosevelt. He earned his, does everyone know that was named after Eleanor Roosevelt? Okay, now you do. He earned his master's degree in public policy at the University of Chicago. Our guest today is a graduate of Loyola University School of Law. There's Loyola. He and his wife, Barbara, live in Chicago's Lakeview neighborhood. He is the proud father of two fabulous daughters, Allison and Megan. Ladies and gentlemen, Congressman Mike Quigley. Congressman? All right, Michael.
Thank you, Jay. Thank you. Thank you all for being here. Good afternoon. Post-election, post-truth. Apparently, I can say whatever I want. All these years, Aviva Bones telling me, no, you've got to be meticulous and you've got to be on point, and that was wrong, apparently. You know, and I speak to a lot of community groups, and sometimes two or three at night. Past election, it is group therapy. People want me to tell them it's going to be okay. Well, let me do my best. First, this is my first time speaking here since we lost our friend Paul Green, who I worked with at Roosevelt. I was a student at Roosevelt, and obviously we all miss him. I saw him the weekend before he passed, and he usually has this unique wit about him. But he was very serious that day, and he was very kind. So to his friends and family, I want you to know it was just an amazing last time I met Paul, and I'm glad we got to have that talk. Second, we lost Rob Sherman. Just this last weekend. He was a longtime candidate for many issues and a candidate for elected office. He was one of my opponents in this most recent general election from the Green Party. Now, I want to preface this by saying he has had an amazing sense of humor, because there was a reporter talking to him about what he wanted to do as a congressman, and, you know, he was an atheist, and he was wanting to get the God off the dollar bill and so forth. So he was talking about those issues, and the reporter said, well, what do you think of this guy, Mike Quigley? And Rob said, oh, I can't think of a bad thing to say about him. So the reporter said, well, what are you thinking? Well, God bless him. I honestly didn't mean, right? So I saw him at the Sun-Times debate, and I came up to him about it, and I said, he goes, no, I have a sense of humor about this, because I want you to know, it didn't bother me at all, and we can kid about that all the time. So, Rob, you apparently now know whether you were right or all of us are wrong. I do want to recognize my friends from Roosevelt and Loyola University here. My chief of staff from Washington, D.C. came in here. Juan, raise your hand, Juan. Yay, Juan. All of my staff who's here is just fantastic. I think I have two women who were extraordinarily important in making sure and helped me get where I am. Chief of staff at the county, Jennifer Kohler, is here. and a woman I think I drove away with my spontaneous, you'll discover this today, stream of consciousness way of delivering messages, Aviva Bowen, who now works for our teachers. A new mommy. And Juan, by the way, is a new dad. He has a new son, Diego. So welcome to the world, everyone. So where are we and how did we get here? The first thought that comes to mind is, how did our country get so polarized? How did we get to the point where Gallup poll finds that 77% of Americans believe we're more divided on key issues than ever before, and 4 in 10 Democrats and Republicans say the other party's policies are so misguided they pose a threat to the nation. Well, I think we've been here before. We had a civil war. You go back far enough, Hamiltonian versus Jeffersonian democracy, read the tenets of those, pretty similar to the breakdown on who voted for whom in the last election. But you know, how do we bear this out and what do we do? What causes this? I want to say, I think, and don't blame Illinois because it's all over the country, the way we draw maps for congressmen is an issue. The fact is, I would tell you the vast majority of my colleagues on both sides of the aisle are far more concerned about their primary election than their general election. For the most part, there are very few contested races. And if anyone thinks, oh, it's just the Democrats in Illinois, let me remind you that we have had many elections in which, back in 2012, for example, House Democratic candidates won 1.4 million more votes than Republicans. But we had 201 seats to the Republicans, 234. So apparently, those are some good maps, too. It has changed the dynamics. And I also think there's a belief that people are more pulled to their extreme values, one way or another. And I hear from my Republican colleagues that they often say the same things in their caucus that I hear in the Democratic caucus. It is a statement prefaced by, you can't be a good Democrat if, you can't be a good Republican if. Right? This is stuff I'd like to move away from. I'm a member of the Bipartisan Budget Working Caucus, member of No Labels. We got things passed out of the Appropriations Subcommittee working on a bipartisan basis. But it's hard to do when you're pushing back against this. Well, what else I think leads to this, and I speak to a lot of high school and college classes, how people are getting their information these days, right? Principally through this, the younger you are. So I think you get less detailed information, and you also are hearing more and more that you want to hear, right? People are more and more downloading sources, writers, blogs that they agree with. They're watching their TV channel, their news source, and they're listening and reading their bloggers and nobody else. So what I always try to encourage folks, younger students to do is become a member of the Atticus Finch School of Policy, especially the Atticus Finch School of Foreign Policy. What's the major tenet? Walk around in the other person's skin for a while and begin to understand them. We don't have a lot of those discussions at this time, and it makes things difficult on any issue that you might care about. I also think it leads to better policy. I did criminal defense for 10 years. If I understood my opponent's argument at least as well as he or she did, I did a better job. But I also began to understand the other side of that issue and how that policy impacts all of us. Let's just ask ourselves, if we really understood the culture and the history of the Middle East beginning, the beginning of the last century, will we really have divided it in the way we did, creating countries with the flick of a pen? Would we really have invaded Iraq and expected to be greeted as victors? Would we really have rejected minority representation in that country, leading to perhaps the most important reason for the formation of ISIS? I think it has its values, not just that we are a better people, but that we have better policy governing our country. So why we are polarized and why that matters. So where do we go from here in finding common ground as Democrats and Republicans and with the Trump administration? I don't think the problem is so much with the Democrats and Republicans, despite the fact that they're pulled to the side by the way maps are drawn and the polarization that we mentioned. But I still think there's enough common ground. The fact is, if given an opportunity, I think they would have reacted appropriately. Well, I thought the Senate Republicans was abhorrent behavior not to take a vote on a Supreme Court nomination. What I often saw, like in the appropriation process, was though Republicans willing to get something done and willing to do a deal. I thought if the Senate bipartisan immigration reform bill had gotten to the House floor, it would have passed. If reasonable measures to keep the government open had gotten to the floor all those days before we shut the government down, those would have passed too. I'll say this, the Trump administration makes this so much more difficult. Remembering how we're pulled to one side or another, it obviously doesn't help when you've just gone through a campaign which can only be described as hate-filled, misogynistic, statements of extraordinary bigotry, xenophobia, and it doesn't just help us try to accomplish something here across the aisle. It makes it hard to make your constituent understand why you're working with this guy. I've never had people say, stand your ground, don't compromise, push back against this president more than any other. And I get it, right? And the appointments, for the most part, have only cemented those concerns in people's minds, right? Let's remember Mr. Bolton, a neocon, right? An unapologetic supporter of the Iraqi war. Extraordinary suggestions that the Russian hacking was done by the President of the United States, right? And you're appointing people to cabinet posts. Now, I get along that political spectrum. We're going to have differences, how we govern ourselves and how we do regulations. But when you make appointments for labor, for energy, for the US EPA, of people who hate that agency, and in many cases, don't think the agency should even exist. Now you have a problem. Where in the world do you find a middle ground with those kind of appointments? These are the people who are going to be administering these programs that matter to all of us. How do you find a middle ground on immigration reform when you began talking about people coming into this country as criminals and rapists, and talking about building a wall and having the Mexicans pay for it? Or on climate change, when the candidate says it's a hoax concocted by the Chinese? On gun violence, when you embrace the Second Amendment entirely and say that no changes need to take place. On choice, when you talk about immediately defunding Planned Parenthood, and you say that women who have abortions should be punished. Where's the middle ground there? How do you find this? It's incredibly difficult. So I would argue that Mr. Trump has to find a middle ground to get anything done. Which Mr. Trump are we talking about? The hate-filled candidate, or the candidate, or the person that we hear is the guy who's the deal maker? How does this work? How does anything get done in this country to benefit anyone here, especially folks in this room? We begin in March, where we have to raise the debt ceiling. And he is the head of the Republican Party that never gets more than 30 or 40 votes to raise the debt ceiling. This is the party that refused to raise the debt ceiling without sequestration, right? Across-the-board cuts that go through 2021. How will they handle that? No matter what he does, I can't imagine, folks, he's going to get enough votes to raise the debt ceiling in March. Right after that, our funding mechanism, this continuing resolution, fades in the middle of April, right? So you got to raise the debt ceiling, you got to fund the government. And at the same time, the president has announced he wants massive increases in military spending, he wants to repeal the health care law, and he wants to pass massive tax cuts. Folks, none of these things work well together. We hear rumors that they are contemplating suspending the debt ceiling. Look, this is magician's work. This is waving a magic wand and saying, we were only kidding the last 20 years. There is no debt ceiling. There is no debt ceiling. It's got to do it. And when the CBO looks at the proposals for those tax cuts and the massive increases in military spending, they're going to dramatically increase the projections for where that debt ceiling is going to be. Now what does he do? Let's look at what's happened in the past. Look at the political spectrum, folks, left versus right in Congress. In the final analysis, let's look at what the Republicans have done in the last 6 years there. Under Speaker Boehner, they have had more Republicans in the House than at any time since the Hoover administration. And what did they get done? They kicked Speaker Boehner out, they shut down the government, and they couldn't pass a budget out of their own caucus. This doesn't give you extraordinary hopes. The Democrats could leave the room, and we'd still have a lack of anything getting done. I mean, genuine chaos. At that time, they could blame the Obama administration, say, oh, it's all his fault, he's going to veto these things. They don't have that choice. I'm sure that your speaker who's coming to talk about the elections will remind you that campaigning is poetry and governing is prose. I'm not sure what you're going to call governing under this administration, under a caucus on the Republican side that this is this split and torn. Oh, past behavior indicates future behavior. What did Speaker Boehner do to try to get things done? He moved to the middle. 7.5 years ago, I won a special election, a great honor. And I sat down after Speaker Pelosi swore me in, and people came up to me on the floor and said, welcome, they gave me advice. Most interesting advice I got that reminds me of today was from Congressman Mark Kirk, congressman at the time. He says, you're gonna get a lot of advice. All you need to know is that anything that gets done here gets done in the middle. Absolutely the case. So Speaker Boehner comes to the centrist fiscal Democrats, right? Liberal on social issues, centrist on fiscal ones, like myself. I'm a new Dem. And offers enough for us to vote for continuing resolutions. Not a budget, mind you, but just a way to keep the government going. So for us, to be honest, that's how core capacity got $100 million, the CTA. That's how we got funding for the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District to build the McCook-Thornton Reservoirs and other things. There were things in that package that weren't great, but I'll give Speaker Boehner credit. He was pushing this forward just to get things done. A little strange even back then, the night we passed one of these, it was called the Cromnibus that night. Leader Pelosi was whipping against that measure, as was the Tea Party. Whipping in favor of this was President of the United States, President of the United States and Speaker Boehner. I'm just giving you a little tip. This is a glimpse of where we're going to have to go. How will these alliances play out? I honestly cannot imagine a scenario in which this president can get that agenda done, unless there's wizardry here, without help from Democrats. Question is, how do we leverage this? How do we move forward? Okay, I'm on the House Appropriations Committee. In January, there's a good chance I'll become a ranking member of that Appropriations Committee. They call them cardinals. A little aside here, I was in Rome when our cardinal became our bishop became a cardinal. An extraordinary experience and a wonderful person who will be great for all of us. But I saw the red hat and I go, yeah. Apparently there's no such red hat, but let's talk. You know, I was willing to work with the Republicans on approaches to get resources to the city of Chicago. You want to do $1 trillion infrastructure bill? You don't have enough votes to pay for it? All right. then why don't you just do this one clean and straight, right? Let's maybe not, you want to raise the debt ceiling and do this, deal with tax reform. Maybe you don't want to defund Planned Parenthood. Maybe you don't want to go after Davis-Bacon, right? Maybe you don't want to gut the Clean Air Act. You don't have to win all those battles that you really screamed about during your election cycle. Now's the time to govern. And if Congressman Kirk was right and everything gets done in the middle, they're going to have to pull back from this extraordinary extremism. And I get it. There are folks on both sides that won't want to get anything done. But we cannot be a government in exile for the next 4 years. This government has to function. My role, as I see it, as an appropriator, is to drive as many resources back to the city of Chicago and my region as I possibly can. You know, I keep making that mistake. I forget the region part, and the mayor reminds me. If I mention region, he goes, "You mean by region, you mean the city of Chicago, right?" Yes, mayor. If you want to get tax reform done, this cannot be just about the 1%, right? He's got to make this work across those aisles, and it's going to take getting centrist votes. And Mr. President-elect, you made it a lot tougher by talking in the most extreme ways possible. You've got to walk back on this. You've got to stop making appointments like Steve Bannon, right? We can't be that kind of country. That isn't the kind of person that should be advising you on a day-to-day basis. So I think there's possibility for common ground. I know that will be difficult for us given where we are, but we have to try. Let me talk a little bit about my other role, and then we'll work on some questions here. And there's a lot of other things to talk about, but I assume that you'll get to it. The Russians hacking. 2 years ago, Leader Pelosi put me on the House Select Committee on Intelligence. And Jan Schakowsky came up to me because she had been on that committee. And she says, "You just think you know things. Now you'll learn things." Right, you know, things that keep you awake at night. And about three times a week, we get briefed in a very secure location about homeland and national, international security issues. I joined in the request that there be a bipartisan, bicameral investigation of the Russian hacking into the election process. It is a great committee. It is very well chaired by Mr. Nunez from California. He is very fair and has been, to this date, folks, very bipartisan and working on all these issues. And to this date, most of the intelligence community has been very forthcoming and sharing what we need to know that keeps us safe. This is a different situation, folks. And in discussing it, I want to talk about the main point for me. I'm the only Democrat in Congress that's a member of those two committees. I'm the only Democrat that is an authorizer and an appropriator for the intelligence community. So some of my remarks are to the president-elect. First of all, very little of what they say is, as you just said, idiotic, especially what they're telling you about what the Russians are doing. Let's just remember a few things. This isn't the Russians' first foray into influencing elections in other countries. Just ask any of the countries in Eastern Europe today just what they're doing to influence elections. Influence is too light a word. Why would anyone imagine that the Russians would draw the line at the United States of America? That they, oh, it's okay to influence elections and hack into computers in Eastern Europe, but we won't do it to the United States of America. That's extraordinarily naive. So the problem I have is it's very difficult for me to talk about what we're getting briefed on and referencing what you might have read in the New York Times and the Washington Post about what took place in those briefings between the CIA and the FBI. Suffice to say, we really need a bipameral bipartisan investigation into Russian hacking into the election process. And oh, by the way, they successfully hacked into two Board of Elections computer systems. One of them, two of the two states, one of them was the state of Illinois. So at the very least, on a bipartisan basis, we should be very concerned about what they're trying to accomplish. Before this happened, being aware of their attempts, what concerned me was people in the intelligence community were saying, oh, there's 9,000 entities that run elections in this country, federal elections, right? So it's so diluted they really couldn't influence. Look, they're just trying to, you know, make this difficult. They're trying to discredit the process, right? So they didn't have to get in the 9,000. I thought if they got in and tried to influence the actual voting process in, I don't know, Dade County, a few others that are extraordinarily important in Ohio, for example, it would have raised quite a problem. And while I don't believe they hacked into the voting process, I am very concerned about all the other successful efforts they have made into influencing our election and what we should do about that. And frankly, Mr. Trump does not know much about intelligence. He doesn't know much about foreign policy. And the worst part is he doesn't know what he doesn't know. What keeps me up isn't all the things I've talked about before. I think it is his makeup that concerns me the most. When challenged, how does he react? When challenged by his own party, how does he react? When challenged, when issues were raised by intelligence community about the Russians' activity, his response is to attack, I'm not going to listen to them. In contrast with what has been referred to as no drama Obama, this is a scary proposition. He's going to be dealing with heads of state who are going to be very difficult, to say the least. So in an increasingly complicated, layered, textured world, his concerns, frankly, frighten me. And the relationship with Mr. Putin, perhaps more than any other. And that reaction is not just mine. It's, as you've heard, Republican senators have expressed extraordinary concern about his relationship and his soon-to-be Secretary of State's relationship with Mr. Putin. I will tell you there are other leaders across the world who have had, their word, bromances with Mr. Putin in which they felt entirely screwed by what took place. This is what's going to happen if you trust Mr. Putin. I've been probably in 30 countries since this election took place, many of them in Eastern Europe. They are questioning their relationship with our country because of Mr. Trump's statements about Russia and Mr. Putin. These are people who are in countries that are very, very important allies for a wide variety of reasons. How, for example, do we talk to the people in Ukraine? How do we talk to them about Russian-occupied areas there? And more importantly, the sanctions that our allies have put in place to work against this. I was in Georgia. Folks, you can go to Georgia and stand on one hill and look out over another hill and watch the Russians move the fences to occupy more of that country. What does it tell Mr. Putin when you say great things about him? What does it tell them other than you have a green light? Whether we believe that or not, I promise you the Russians believe that, and I promise you the Georgians believe that, the Lithuanians believe that, and all the countries in the Baltics believe that, the Ukrainians believe that this is a dangerous time. And finally, in Syria, while we need desperately to have a diplomatic solution, and Russia must play a role in it, this extraordinary overemphasis in their view of being close to Russia is particularly dangerous for our friends who are battling against the Assad regime and the Kurds and the whole list of others and how it involves and plays into Iraq and so forth. So aside from that, it's just all good news. Look, this is a different time, folks. And I know we're going to get to your questions, but these are new challenges. This is not your father's war. This isn't a rational entity that we're going to have a peace treaty with after 4 years of battle and become allies with. The battle's on our own turf, right? Putin is far more likely to launch a cyber attack than a nuclear attack. The bad guys aren't in uniforms. They can recruit our young people through a computer cable to turn them on, and we have to be fixated on dealing with that. And that's how we fund homeland and national security versus the Cold War footing that we're still funding, which makes absolutely no sense. So many more things to talk about. Jay always asked me, do you still like the job? I like the job. It's an extraordinary challenge. I'll say this. When the president was here for his last time as president of the United States, we were at the tarmac at O'Hare, and I greet him. I'm with the mayor, and he starts walking toward his helicopter, and he says, do you want to ride downtown? Now, I quickly realize he's not talking Uber. For a kid who grew up in Carroll Stream, Illinois, my dad worked for the phone company, my mom is a school teacher, they gave me every opportunity. In a billion years, I don't imagine I'm flying with the mayor and the city of Chicago and the president of the United States over Lakeview and Wrigley Field and the lake and the most beautiful city in the world that I'd be here. I do see, folks, better days. I still prefer to see an America guided by the better angels of our nature that doesn't pit one group against each other or find scapegoats, that recognizes climate change, gun violence, and inequality are real issues, that understands that Planned Parenthood reduces abortions and provides critical health care to millions of American women, that recognizes that the forces of hate have no places in the halls of government, that understands that there is more that unites us than divides us, and that we should walk away from those dark forces into the bright light of the most extraordinary democracy in the world. Thank you for having me. I'll answer your questions. Thank you.
Okay, if anyone has any questions, just hold up your blue card and our staff will be around to pick them up. We already have a few here.
I guess.
Oh, yeah. He has his private supply, Miles.
Thank you, Miles.
Absolutely.
And someday I'll come here and they'll have Super Dog.
Oh, yeah. Congressman recognized Roosevelt and Loyola, but we also have two other universities here that are sponsoring the program, and I know they want to be recognized. I know we have DePaul University over here. In addition to these three intellectual powerhouses, we have representatives from that great athletic powerhouse, Northwestern University. Where are you?
Right there. John Borovica.
Good. Good luck in your bowl game against Pittsburgh. Anyhow, first question from Ashton Ladd over here. Congressman, what will be your approaches to get your colleagues on the far left to come to the middle?
I think the motivation is principally what I mentioned. We can't be a government in exile for 4 years. And while we have become principally messengers, we are messaging things unless we're actually accomplishing those. It's in our interest to try to find some victories as we go forward. One opportunity toward that vein, Speaker Ryan has promised a vote on earmarks in March. Folks, if he does that, it will pass, and all of my colleagues will have opportunities, again, part of a working together process, moving toward the middle to bring things back to their district and become relevant to accomplish things that we were elected to get done. So that's at least one measure to try to do that.
Thank you. This question is from Sandy Stein over here on our left. Is this going to be the Trump administration or the Pence administration? How much influence do you think Mike Pence will have?
Well, I think Mr. Pence has already had an extraordinary amount of influence on this administration, given the relative zero experience that so many other people in this administration are, and the folks that they're bringing in. Almost the Secretary of State that they're nominating and very few of the others have any government experience. So I think you're going to see a vice president with, for the longest time, as I can remember, unprecedented influence on the president of the United States. And I'll tell you, he understands government far more than they do, but he brings whole new areas of concern. I don't know that Mr. Trump has a philosophy. Mr. Pence does, which scares me, particularly when it comes to issues like choice, the environment, and equality for everyone.
Thank you. We have some really good questions here, folks, and keep them coming. This is from Tom Kotarek. Tom, where are you? Over there on our left. He's with CMAP, the Chicago Metropolitan Agency for Planning. Printed, easy to read. Rural members of Congress attempted to eliminate funding for mass transit in 2012. Do you think that will happen again next year?
Absolutely. I mean, chairman of the Appropriations Committee a couple years ago, I think it's probably the same time, said, we have so little money, we need to just the important things, like roads and bridges. Coming from a state that has not arguably, statistically, the worst roads and bridges in the country, hey, that's great. But we also have a CTA and Metra, which needs, Metra needs help with positive train control and new rolling stock and switching outside these stations, beautifully mastered during the Hoover administration. And the CTA carries more people than Amtrak, and they do it in about a month. So, and I think he needs to address the fact that the Republicans do that millennials apparently are not buying cars the way I did at their age. They're getting around some other ways, which is great, but we don't only need to draw resources into critical needs, we need to build for the next century, not the last one.
Thank you, Congressman. This is from one of your colleagues, Joe Moore, the alderman of the 49th Ward, fighting 49th, Joe. So far, Trump's cabinet appointments are either manifestly unqualified and are ideological extremists. How to advise your Democratic Senate colleagues, how would you advise your Democratic Senate colleagues to approach the confirmation hearings? Oppose all appointments or pick their battles?
Well, I think it's always fair to pick their battles. You don't want to be Mitch McConnell, as he said when President Obama came into office. Our most important task is to get rid of President Obama. I think you go in there with the spirit of bipartisan cooperation, pick your battles. I think there's one or two appointments so far that I think folks are going to be able to live with. I think you draw the line where it gets to that extreme. The inexperience issue, you can sort of overcome. It's where they stand on these issues that really frightens me. Mr. Mattis, I was told by many military experts, will need a lot of people around him who understand the financial aspects of these issues, the waste that exists in the military, and how to address that. But otherwise, he can overcome these inexperience in those one areas. I think you pick your spots, and then you ally with the Republicans who have similar concerns about some of these appointments and say, you're not going to get this one. I would hope that some of those conversations would have already taken place.
Now, along that line, I think this morning President-elect Trump announced that his pick to head the EPA was former governor of Texas Rick Perry, who said he wanted
energy.
The one he couldn't remember that department in the debate and said he wanted to eliminate it. Would you think that would be a big battle between his confirmation or not?
Well, I think that'll be a difficult one. I think that what's interesting to me, first, as I said before, I don't think it makes sense to appoint someone who thinks an agency should not exist. The battle's in the middle about how to regulate, to an extent, how much to regulate. That's all fair game. But this goes beyond the pale, and it makes absolutely no sense. And Mr. Perry's problems are manyfold. But I think that the Trump administration on this kind of issue is going to run into, ironically, the market. Mr. Trump has said he doesn't believe in climate change and that we need to revive the coal industry. Absolutely fascinating. Someone can correct me, but I think they're getting about $30 a ton for coal. To make it competitive in the market, so anybody would want it, they would have to subsidize it at about $30 a ton. Where have the open market folks gone? We're breeding a strange brew of Republicans these days who, if they believe in that, think it's good economics. That makes absolutely no sense. Natural gas is where people are going to go, competing against the coal industry. And I'm for helping the coal miners, but we're talking about 83,000 roughly jobs. I'm for retraining, and to the extent that there's still work, they're great. Help them every way you can. But you have to move the decimal point over to give you the figures on how many people are working in the renewable energy market, which is, as our president today tells you, is the wave of the future. So I think the Senate should work against them, but I do know that the market forces will work against those who believe in this sort of fairy tale.
Thank you. This is from City Club member Todd Shaleen. Todd, where are you? Way back there in the bleachers. Great. If you were forced to say something nice about the president-elect, what would it be?
I don't know that I would say something nice about him. What I would say to him in the nicest way possible is this. You don't need to bluster anymore. You don't need to fight. You don't need to be so demagogic about issues. You're the leader of the United States of America and the free world. You don't have to bluster. You're the guy. Just listen to people. Appreciate the fact that you don't know what you don't know. And the hawk doesn't have to attack a gnat, right? He watches Saturday Night Live and feels compelled to respond when he doesn't like a skit. Look, let me put that into perspective. There's a Mother Jones article called The War's Not Fought. Came out last year, and there was an Atlantic article that came out about this, comparing what the far-right guys in the Senate would have done in different instances versus the President of the United States. And their calculations is they would have got us into 12 wars with troops on the ground. The personality matters. Every once in a while, you got to put your ego in your back pocket. I don't know if this president is capable of doing that. Go back and ask yourselves, what has that led to with previous presidents? Reread Carroll's book about Johnson in the days leading up his decision to go forward in the Vietnam War. Literally, he was saying the same sorts of things. America can't be embarrassed, right? And you can't push us around. You can't. This is a dangerous time on its own. I would suggest that our current president's diplomacy has saved us losing a lot of American lives in conflicts across the world. So, I'll close this question by saying this. I saw the president at the White House for the Christmas party the other day. I said, we miss you already.
Thank you. Well put. This is from Brian Bernadoni, who's with the Illinois Association of Realtors. Could you define sanctuary city, and how will that designation impact Chicago?
Sanctuary city has different definitions because there's a lot of sanctuary cities. City of Chicago is one. There are many others. So there's a legal definition within each ordinance passed, but basically it says that they will not aid in getting rid of people who are here who are undocumented for a wide variety of reasons. Those reasons are varied with each one of those ordinances across the country. I think what's important to recognize with that is if you had comprehensive immigration reform, we wouldn't be talking about sanctuary cities.
Okay, thank you. This is from Ed Bacharach, who's with the Center for Pension Integrity. Ed, where are you? Okay, straight back. His question is, Congressman, public employee pensions are a crushing burden on Chicago and Illinois. Is there a role for the federal government in solving this problem?
I suggest there might be a role that comes about with, first of all, assisting local governments. The easiest thing to do is to help local governments, state and local, get through their fiscal crisis that they're going through right now. Take some of that pressure off them toward this end. When it comes to specific means of helping local pensions, you're going to get all caught up in what just began. It's a good question with coal miners, right? We had a senator threaten to shut down the country because he wanted to make sure the pensions of the coal miners were taken care of. The questions that came back were, well, what about the pensions for these other private sector companies? What about the pensions of all these government worker sectors that are in peril? Suggest there's a much, much longer answer to your question. Love to sit down and talk to you about that. But that role is going to involve all those other pensions tied into it. And I suggest that it's probably going to get kicked off as we talk about comprehensive tax reform as well. So love to talk about it further, but for now recognize it's going to be intertwined with public-private partnerships dealing with the pension issues across the country.
Thank you. I have two questions left. One deals with foreign affairs and one domestic affairs, I guess. This is from Becky Carroll, C Strategies. Becky, where are you today? Right here. Great, of course. Everybody knows Becky. the AP has reported a ceasefire reached in Aleppo, Syria. What can the U.S. do to ensure that civilians and children are safely evacuated from the city and safe from retaliation from the Assad regime?
A complicated diplomatic solution, it's there to be had. We're going to have to figure out who's going to be the force on the ground that aids those civilians in escaping and getting out of there. It's going to require a tremendous amount of financial assistance dealing with where people live, their health care, what are the decisions that are going to be made. I was in Jordan visiting one of the camps for refugees coming out of Syria. It's packed. Right, and Europe, you're starting to see the pushback from Europe. The United States needs to step up and play a role in finding a home. In the short term, it is absolutely going to require a diplomatic solution involving all of the participants, with the exception of ISIS and a few of the other extremists in the region. We're going to need Assad's assistance, and we're absolutely going to need the Russian assistance in keeping Assad to his word on those points. Going to involve the relationships and what's taking place in bordering countries, the problems that our Turks are having with the Kurds there, how it affects the Kurds elsewhere. So everything's interconnected, but I had not seen this, and I suspect we'll be working on this when I get off the podium today. Thank you.
This is from Dave Hanna. Dave, where are you? You're not here? Oh, okay, fine. In light of the position of the Democratic Party now finds itself in, have you considered moving your leadership focus from local and regional issues to the national level within the party?
I probably haven't announced what I've tried to do on the national basis. My job, as I see it first and foremost, is to regain control of the United States House of Representatives. I've done that by helping people running in those races, by starting to help people dealing with the recruitment. So the answer is yes, I think I already have. But it's hard to step away from home when there's so much uncertainty and so many problems. My first job was in Chicago, was an aide to Alderman Bernie Hansen. And then I was a Cook County Commissioner. And it's really hard to forget all that matters to me and all that time I spent here. I love my city, I love my state. So the nebulous answer is I'm not giving up locally, statewide, or nationally in all the things that matter to all of us in this room. Thank you so much for having me. Have a great holiday season.